Good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining us in this new BCN Analytics session. As usual, an exciting topic, how to build a data organization. For those of you active in social networks, that's going to be the hashtag, CNDataOrg. I'm not going to ask about Periscope, because each time I ask this question, I get less people saying they use Periscope. But if you Periscope, please do it. So we have an exciting topic. And when preparing this, I was doing a bit of a research about data organizations. And the first thing I found made me really, really happy is this survey from Fortune 1000 companies, so big, big companies, private companies. And some data. This year, 54% of companies report having a chief data officer, which is, I guess, great news, taking into account that in 4 years ago, it was only 12%. So it's like, seems that organizations are really like understanding the role of a chief data officer. Also, 62.5 companies were reporting they were having a big data project in production. So again, it's not only they have their people, the chief data officer, but also like big data project, right? So it's like really made me happy, and I think it should make us happy seeing that companies are betting, are investing resources and time on chief data. But it's not only the private sector, right? Because I was kept doing some research, and I found, for instance, Washington DC, they are hiring the first chief data officers. It's not only the private companies are really investing on that because they see the value of data, it's that even like DC, for instance, is investing. And the same applies to Colorado. In fact, if you go to basically any US city, you will find that most of the cities are hiring data officers, chief data officer. Even like more exciting, how many of you have seen the movie Moneyball? Yeah, raise your hand. So you know the movie, right? So this is the guy where the movie is based on. It's called Paul DePesta. So he has been named chief strategy officer. So it's not only that data is important, you know the story of the guy that he was using data to make the team perform better. It's now it's a strategy. So it's really, it seems the companies are really putting resources, and even the clubs, the soccer or the football teams are putting resources on this. So private sector, major, so a lot of, let's say, companies or associations really betting on data. Or even The Guardian wonders if UK should have a chief data officer. So after this slide, she's like, okay, we are in the right track. So everything is super easy. It's like companies understand the value, organizations understand the value. Well, you all know it's not that easy, because it sounds good, but there are some challenges ahead, as usual. So how do you create a data-driven organization? You know, some companies are really like still opinionated or not based in discussions in data. So it's still a lot of things to be done. It's also, and I guess some of you will face this challenge, how do you acquire and retain the talent? It's not only a matter of being a data-driven organization. You need the right people working, and that's talent, and there's a scarce resource, so it's a lot of like effort required to acquire and retain those people. And also building the right infrastructure, hardware, software. I think the ecosystem is becoming really, really complex, and there are some very good vendors offering great technologies and great solutions, and there are other vendors which are not that good. And at the end, it's becoming challenging for organizations to understand what is the technology or the platform I should be using, right? So this is like, the exciting slide before is like, yes, the organizations are really betting on data, but the ecosystem is becoming challenging. And also, I guess some people mentioned me, this discussion they are having is like, do you need a chief data officer? Do you need a chief analytics officer? Or do you need a chief insights officer, right? So all this debate is just to illustrate that, yes, we all see the value of data and how to use it, but at the end, it's like not that easy, right? So that's why we have here like fantastic speakers, that will help us to understand how are they facing in their organization this how to build a data organization. But before getting into that, let me do some bit of housekeeping on BCN Analytics. Just as a reminder, we have an active job board, so we know a lot of companies are publishing offers. So for those of you looking for new opportunities, you've seen companies like Nespresso, Bistaprint, Hewlett-Packard, eDream, Solidio, so different companies are posting job offers. So in case you're interested, you could visit our job section. Also, you may remember that last year we had a hackathon together with Social Point, so UN Forces, and really it was a great experience. So we said, hey, why won't we do it again? So that happened. 10 days ago, we had a hackathon. So instead of me explaining what happened, I'm going to ask Sharon Bigger, head of analytics at Social Point, to explain how was it. Sharon? May I ask a spontaneous applause? Yeah? Thank you.
Hi, good evening, everyone. As Manuel said, last weekend we held a datathon in Social Point. We had 40 people taking part. In fact, we had a lot more people wanting to take part, but unfortunately, we only had space for 40 people. So it's great to see that the demand is out there for this kind of thing. The challenge the teams had to face was to build a recommendation system for one of our games, Monster Legends. So Monster Legends is a free-to-play game that you can download on your iPhone or Android device. The game is about collecting monsters and then battling with them. So there are over 700 monsters in the game. And what we did was we took a sample of 100,000 players, and then we divided that into a training and a test set. And in the test set, we removed one monster at random, and the teams had to figure out which monster we had removed. So it was quite a challenging task for them. We had planned to give 3 prizes. In the end, we ended up giving 4, and I'll explain why. The first 2 prizes were for the best model. Okay, so we measured that in terms of precision. How many monsters did they get right out of the monsters that we had taken away? We also gave the teams a baseline model in R just to get them started with a precision that was fairly low at 15%. At the end of 24 hours, the winning team had increased that up to 39%, so they'd done a really great job. So the 2 teams on the left here, they both won for having the best algorithms, the best model. Then after 24 hours of coding and hardcore data science, we then asked them to write a presentation on their results. So not only did we want them to be good at actually quantitative techniques, but we really wanted them to be able to explain what they had done and be able to communicate to a business audience who might not understand machine learning, who might not understand the algorithms behind it. So we brought together a jury of 4 people, myself, the CEO from Social Point, Horacio, Professor Pompey Fabra, Christian, and Emmanuel from eDreams. And the 4 of us judged the presentations. Each team had 8 minutes to present their findings, and they were judged on, did they give good insights that Social Point could leverage to use what they had discovered to improve the games? And in fact, the jury found it so difficult to decide that we ended up giving 2 prizes in that category as well. So congratulations to all of those who won during the Datathon. One thing to let you know, the event was filmed by Spanish TV. They are in the process of making a documentary on big data. So they were with us for the whole weekend. Some lucky people got to be interviewed. And that documentary will be on television in January of next year. We will let you know when so that you can take a look and see how they are reporting on big data. Social Point is very proud to sponsor this event, and we are very happy to do it. We do it because we believe that Barcelona can be a hub for analytics in Europe, and we're very behind BC Analytics and their vision to achieve that. So we are planning to do it next year, and I hope to see you all there in October or November of next year. Thank you.
So thank you, Sharon. I have to say I was there on Sunday. It's important of voting, and I think it's at tremendous value. So I didn't sign any confidentiality agreement with you guys, but I didn't disclose anything else. But it was really interesting. Tremendous value added by the people in terms of insights for the Social Point, and also a good opportunity for Social Point to identify talent. So my recommendation is that any company really investing in data should have this approach, because it's really a fantastic opportunity to connect with the community. So that was regarding the housekeeping. So session today, we have, as usual, our panel, 50 minutes. So we have 2 fantastic speakers, Adam Kinney. My colleague Paul will present him later, but I have to say big thanks to Adam because he's coming from Norway. Also, he recently was a father, so it's like we really appreciate the time you took it took you to come here. Yeah, so we are really thankful. We also have Pau Contreras. Not sure if you have been a father recently, but you are coming from Madrid, so it's also like so it's, you were already a father. It's not like okay, good. So that's going to be the speakers. Then we'll have, as usual, time for Q&A. So initially, Pau will handle that, and then we will leave open for the audience to ask any questions. So really invite you and encourage you to participate, because it's when the beauty comes. As usual, after that, we have networking time there with cold beers and water, so we can have some fun and get along together. And then for those who want to stay longer, we go to this George Penny place. It's becoming our place, so it's really close here. I copy this slide from each presentation, so it's the same one every time, but it's basically in Urquinaona, in case you want to go. So before just moving into the panel, just again, big thanks to Schibsted. They are sponsoring this session, so these people out there are recording. So later on, you can enjoy the content on YouTube or share with your friends and review the best moments of the session. Also, big thanks also to Mobile World Center because they share this venue with us and we can use it. And obviously, Estrella Damm because they are the ones delivering the beers. So with no further delay, Pau, all yours. Yep. You run the show. Thank you.
All right, the first speaker is Adam Kinney. He is the VP of Data and Analytics at Schibsted. For those of you who are not familiar with this industry, is a big media and classified ads company based in Oslo, but they have a big data science unit here in Barcelona and also in other cities in Europe. It's an interesting case because it was probably one of the first media groups to realize that and to do something about it, that their business was moving online. So. Adam Kinney, as I said, is the VP of Data and Analytics. Previously, he was the head of analytics at Twitter. He holds a math degree from the North Texas University and a master's in statistics from Stanford University. So, Adam, the floor is yours.
All right, thank you for having me. It's exciting to talk to data enthusiasts always in any venue. So I'm going to talk about several different issues and kind of focus in on particularly contentious issues in how do you build and structure data teams. And so the first thing that I want to get to with that is, there we go, okay, there. But why? Why is this important? So, you know, if you're working in management related to data, then, you know, the connection to, you know, this is kind of obvious. You have to think about how you're going to structure a team. So if you're going to be a line manager for a team, you have to think about the way that you're going to hire the right people, the way that you're going to build the right relationships with other parts of the organization to make sure that you're actually having an impact. If you're in a more senior level position, then you have to think about whole groups of teams and how they're all going to both work with each other and how you're going to execute on an overall data strategy that's going to provide maximum value for your company. So if you're not in management, if you're an individual contributor, if you're a data scientist, if you're an engineer working on data applications, the reason why this is relevant is actually this topic has more to do with your day-to-day happiness in your job probably than just about anything else. So things that can come up a lot of times are, for example, you'll have gone to school for a long time to develop a lot of specialized training, and then you find yourself in a job where you're doing a lot of like very basic SQL queries over and over you know, the sales team or something like that, and you feel like, okay, well, why did they hire me and bring me in here if this is what I'm going to do all day? And, you know, there's all kinds of other problems that can come up like that. And usually the problem is because the team isn't set up in the right way or you haven't established the right working procedures or relationships with other parts of the organization. So that those are some of the things that I'm going to zero in on here. So to break down overall, there's three kinds of teams that you typically find in data. And so I'm going to briefly talk about what each one of them is, and then I'm going to go into some different structural issues with teams, and I'll address each of those three with each of those issues. So data infrastructure and tools is the first one. So this is called a lot of different things depending on the exact team and the company. So sometimes it's called business intelligence. Sometimes it's called data engineering. In Schibsted, it's called data platform. But this is the capability to collect all the data that you need, hopefully in one place, and process that data. So if you need to enable other teams to set up batch processing pipelines, if you need to enable data scientists to run ad hoc MapReduce jobs or to schedule MapReduce jobs, if you need even real-time data streams or anything like that. So there should be one team that's providing all the technology for that kind of thing. So that's data infrastructure and tools. The second one is insights. So insights is the one that usually has, just to preview some of the things I'll be talking about in a few minutes, insights is the area that ends up being the most contentious in my experience. So working in different companies and talking to people that are working in data organizations in different companies, there's usually a lot of angst or confusion or indecision about how to properly set up insights. So what is insights? So this is where you're studying the product and you're trying to understand the product or the business by studying the data. So you want to understand user behavior. You want to understand, so if you're in the context of like a consumer app, so you're going to care about things like, you know, ultimately what you care about is how much money you're making because it's a business. So important contributing factors to that might be the revenue you can make per user or the number of active users. And so you want to understand for each of those things, okay, what are the main drivers of revenue per user? What are the main drivers of the active user counts? How do you get users to stay in the product longer? How do you get new users in particular to stay? How do you keep users from leaving? And all of these questions you have to investigate and understand if you're actually going to get a handle on how to drive these metrics forward as an organization. So that's the job of insights. And then the third one is data products and data features. So what I mean by that is a product or feature that both depends on data and has some kind of machine learning or artificial intelligence component to it, or a statistical model. So there's some kind of quantitative modeling that is involved in bringing this feature about, and it's a production service that is either user-facing or it's used internally in some kind of production capacity where it has to have good uptime and things, all those good things. So those are the three kinds of teams. Now let's talk about the structural issues. So the first one is usually the most contentious one. This is, should the team be central? Should it be one central team that does this thing for everybody in the company? Or should it be distributed? Should there be several of these teams? Or should it be that this particular function is embedded in a bunch of different teams? The reason why this is contentious, I think, is because you can't help but get into politics and like who owns what and things like that. And that's going to naturally, in any kind of human organization, that's going to be a contentious thing. So I find that it's helpful to have a principled framework for thinking about the centralized versus distributed thing, because it helps kind of sidestep the political aspects of it and kind of get to, okay, how do we structure things so that we're providing the most value? So let's run through each of the kinds of teams and see what kind of frameworks make sense. So for a data infrastructure team, I think it's, for those of us who work with data, I think there's a lot of obvious reasons why you would want a single team working on the infrastructure and tooling that people are going to use to process data and to access data and to generate dashboards and things like that. The reason being, if you have multiple teams doing it, it seems like there's no way that could happen, but you're having duplication of effort. And B, you want one place to go to get all of your data. So if there's tremendous value in having all of the data collected together in one place. You don't have to learn a bunch of different systems, for example, if you're a data scientist. You learn one tech stack, and then once you've mastered that tech stack, then you can kind of navigate through any area of the business, and it makes you a lot more versatile. It makes the work a lot more efficient. So the exception to this is when there's a capability that you need that doesn't exist yet, and it's only needed by one team. So an example of this from Twitter was we had a data infrastructure team, and they had, it back in those days, it was like Pig and Hive and things like that. And so there was a tech stack that we had to run MapReduce jobs and to schedule those. But we didn't have real-time data streams. And in fact, real-time data streams was kind of a new thing at that time. And this was the original storm work that was done. That wasn't done within the data infrastructure team at Twitter, because that was needed for one particular product. That product, it was to show advertisers real-time feedback on how their promoted tweets were performing. That's the only reason that it was needed at that time. So that work was developed by the team that was building that analytics for advertisers product. Now, it turns out that real-time data streams are a really useful thing. And so eventually, there were other teams that needed this kind of thing. And when you hit that point where you hit multiple use cases where the thing is going to be useful, then you should take a hard look at, are we going to get more efficiency here and make things a lot easier for everybody if we move that functionality into the data infrastructure group and then let the teams that need real-time data streams to just worry about the other parts of their product, and then they don't have to worry about setting up the streams. So then if you're thinking about insights, this is the one that actually becomes the most controversial. Like, there's a lot of big companies that have changed the way that they organize their insights groups. So for example, Facebook used to have a central team, and then they changed to a distributed embedded kind of team. LinkedIn has done similar kinds of changes. There were similar kinds of changes that we did at Twitter. And so there's something here, because like, it's really common that people struggle with this and are not happy with the organizational setup that they have for insights. I think that the fundamental problem comes in that there's two important aspects to insights. And one of those kind of intuitively points to a centralized team, and the other one points to a distributed team. So for the distributed one, let's imagine that you're a product manager working at a, so I all my examples are in the context of consumer internet companies, because like, that's all I've ever worked with. So forgive me if you don't work in that, but hopefully it carries over. So imagine you're a product manager and you're introducing a new feature. And one of the things that you're going to need to do, one of the many things, is make sure that your feature is properly instrumented. So you're collecting data. You want to define KPIs. You want to track those over time and understand how users are interacting with your new feature, and use that as feedback to an input into your future product planning. So if you're that product manager, would you rather have an embedded, dedicated data analyst who you can give specific instructions to and who is going to care deeply about your feature because that's the only thing she or he works on? Or do you want to work with a central team where you have to get in line with everybody else and they're going to have a lot of things that they need to do and a lot of things they care about? And the way I'm setting this up kind of obviously points to the conclusion is, if you're that product manager, you want a dedicated analyst embedded in your team. Okay, so that's kind of, that's what I call the bottom-up aspect of insights, that you need people thinking deeply about specific areas of the product and specific areas of the business if you're going to be successful, because a central team is going to become a bottleneck. So now let's look at it from another angle. Let's say that for the company's next year's revenue target, you want to make sure the entire organization is aligned around a particular revenue target. Okay, well, in order to do that, you need to break down revenue into the core drivers. And so going back to my consumer web example, you're going to care about the things like revenue per user and active user growth and user engagement and all those kinds of things. You're going to need to understand these in pretty good detail in order to, A, pick a reasonable target that is ambitious but still realistic enough that people don't get demotivated, And you're also going to want to manage different aspects of the business to this metric and hold them accountable for their contributions to it. In order to do that, you got to know, okay, are we going to invest resources in improving revenue per user, or are we going to invest resources in just increasing the number of active users, or are we going to do both? You have to have a pretty sophisticated understanding of how user growth relates to revenue and what are the ways that you can most easily influence those drivers if you're going to do that in a reasonable way. Now, if you have an organization where all of the data analysts are embedded with different product teams, who's going to do that work? Probably nobody. So then you have a problem. You do need a central team if you're going to have this data-driven kind of approach to the way you manage a business. So the solution that I've found works the best is a mixture of both. So you do want a central team that's working on understanding at a deep level the drivers of the business, and in particular, user behavior in your product. And you also need people that are focused on specific teams and specific features and specific aspects of the business. So you have a central team and you have embedded people, but I am a big believer in having everybody part of a single organization so that if you're embedded, you sit with a team and you're dedicated 100% of the time to that team, and that team's manager decides what your roadmap is. They decide what questions you're going to try to answer this quarter. But you have a manager who's part of the central group, and that keeps you in the loop in terms of knowledge sharing, in terms of methodology. If you're really going to make a data-driven organization work where you understand the relationships between the metrics that all teams are driving towards, then you're going to have that connection with the central team. So it doesn't always have to be a reporting line. That's the way that I've done it, and it works well in my experience. But there's a lot of different ways to do it. But the point is that you do need to get this balance between distributed and centralized right in insights in particular. Now, for data products, it's a bit different. Usually a data product is developed for one particular use case, and so it can sit wherever in the organization that makes it easiest to do. Schibsted is actually a bad example of this because Schibsted has many products, and so everything that we do, it makes a lot of sense to do things in a more centralized way. But I think generally speaking, it makes a lot of sense to just wherever you find the use case, then have the team just, you know, in an agile, lean kind of way, just get started and get something out the door. You often don't need the real machine learning AI kind of horsepower in the beginning anyways to get an MVP out. But when improving the sophistication of the algorithm gets very hard, when you find you need more expertise, when you find that the system that you're building shares a lot in common with similar kinds of data products and systems, then the balance starts to swing much more towards centralized teams. Okay, types of skill sets. I'll cover this one quickly because I'm probably taking up a good bit of time here. So for data infrastructure teams, obviously you're going to want engineers like backend engineers and data warehousing kinds of people, like those kinds of skill sets generally. For insights, this is where, again, there's a little bit more complication. I find that it's helpful to have both data analysts and data scientists, and I draw a distinction between those two things. So data analysts, in my opinion, are people who are more likely to be embedded with products. Their career path is not as much on the increasing technical sophistication and impact of what you do on a technical level. It's increasing expertise in a particular product or business domain area. So you really understand this part of the product or this part of the business really well, and that's the kind of knowledge you can bring, and that's how you have a bigger impact over time. Data scientists, I find, in my definition anyways, they're much more technically oriented in that, so they're more likely to have an advanced degree, for one thing. They're more likely to be motivated by doing research that can be applied in several different product or business domains. So their career growth is going to be much more technically focused, and in doing things on the technical side that have leverage in many different parts of the product or the business. Then for data products, I'm a big believer in hybrids. So I look for data products, people who have software engineering and data science skills. And some of them have the title of data scientist, some of them have the title of software engineer, but the ideal hybrid is the kind of person who, if you didn't know their title, you wouldn't be able to figure it out really, because they can write code pretty well and they can also do the data science pretty well. If you get a group of those people together, almost always good things happen with respect to data products. Okay, so finally, development paths. That's the last aspect I'm going to cover here. So for data infrastructure, basically you're going to find a basic set of needs that you need to fulfill. The idea is you want to get a minimum in place for each of those if you're starting from scratch. So you want, it truly is like a minimum viable product kind of thing. You want some kind of ability to collect the data and to schedule jobs and all that. And it's not going to be user friendly, and the data scientists are going to complain and they're not going to like it, but you're going to at least have the basic functionality in place. Once you have that running, once you actually have customers and users in the organization, then you start to understand where the real pain points are, and it helps you much better to direct your resources and focus to the areas that are most painful for your users. Before you get that out the door, I find that usually when you try to guess where the pain points are, you get it wrong. So it's best to get something in the hands of some customers first, and then you start to figure out these are the areas we should focus on. For I'll cover insights last, but for data products, I find that you want a depth-first approach. So there's a lot of danger with data products. So for example, like recommendation systems and search and things like that, that you try to take on too many applications at once. I think it's really beneficial to focus on nailing one application and then showing that you can improve your metrics. So if you're trying to, for example, improve user engagement through recommendations, you should be able to show that you can actually sustain some improvement there, and only then take on additional use cases. That provides the focus that the team needs, and it also sets a tone for how are you going to actually innovate on the algorithmic side while you're also running a service, and it kind of forces you into showing that you can do that as a team before you add to the complexity. So finally, for insights, there's a specialized kind of development path that I think about: measure, understand, and manage. So in the first phase, you just want to measure as many things as you can that are going to be critical to the business. So you want to, you know, define KPIs, and you want to make sure that you have everything instrumented, and you want to make sure that you're collecting the data. The data is high quality. You can trust it. You can make dashboards and all that good stuff. The second phase is you want to build understanding. So the metrics are moving around. You want to understand why that is. So is it because of a competitor? Is it because of poor user retention in your product? Is it because of the economy slowing down in market X? So there's a lot of different things that could be influencing your metrics, and you have to go through an exercise of understanding them. That's the second phase. And then the third phase is where you can get into true data-driven business, where you're managing the business according to the data. So you understand why the metrics are moving the way they are. That allows you to forecast and set realistic targets, and then you can align the entire organization around them, because you understand how what everybody in the organization is doing maps to a small number of overall business objectives. Okay, so just to summarize, these are the different components and some thoughts on how to set it all up. I do think that there's a lot of value in having one overall organization where all of these kinds of teams sit together, because it allows for knowledge sharing, it allows for everybody to learn from everybody else. There's a lot of similarities between the work that each of these teams do. And so, you know, there's good reasons to not do that sometimes, but whenever possible, I'm a big believer in having a unified data organization. So that's it for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Adam. You can start thinking questions. We'll do then a round of questions. Let me just tell you in advance that we will prefer shorter questions to longer questions. This way we have a chance to give an opportunity to more people to speak. Our next speaker is Pau Contreras. Pau Contreras is the Chief Data Officer at Unidad Editorial, and as he will explain later, is the mother company of many newspapers and other and magazines that I'm sure that you're familiar with. Previous to that, Pau was Senior Director of Strategic Sales at Oracle, among which big data products. He holds a degree in social anthropology and then a PhD in political science. So Pau, welcome, the floor is yours. Let me get.
Thank you very much. Okay, so, bona tarda a tothom. Thank you very much, Pau, for inviting me to participate in this session. It's a real pleasure. For many reasons. The first one is that this, for me, it's a fantastic excuse to be in here in Barcelona, which is my home city. It's fantastic. The second is that, if we are contributing to this idea of making Barcelona a hub in big data and analytics, I think that this is an important thing. Then we can spend more time in Barcelona, which is always a good idea. And last but not least, because this speech is giving me the opportunity to express myself in English. During the last year, I haven't been able to do that. So I'm hoping that is going to be understandable for you. In my previous life, I work in a multinational company. So my change to Unidad Editorial was a really, really interesting change. So as Pau was explaining, these are our brands. Unidad Editorial is one of the biggest media groups in Spain. As you can see here, there are many, many brands. I'm supposing that many of you are accessing some of these brands, maybe in sports, maybe in economics, maybe in general information. So we have many, many brands. Most of them are leaders, maybe second in their categories. And also we have many, many magazines. So we, as a media company, we are exposed to what is called the digital transformation. I'm sure that you have heard of this many, many times. In our case, digital transformation is a real issue. It's exciting, it's difficult, it's complex, and in fact, it's scary. It's like being at the edge of an abyss, because we are experiencing, as an industry, a total transformation of our business models. Just to give you a concrete data on this, 8 years ago, the revenue from the two levers of any media company, these two levers are circulation of newspapers, print newspapers, and then advertising. These two levers went down 50% as an average in Spain. So as you can imagine, we are basically exposed to a real transformation of our business models. So we need to make a lot of things if we want to be basically a viable corporation. And this is what we are trying to do. This is our biggest challenge. So what I'm going to do is basically convey 3 points to you. The first one is, what is the context of this digital transformation? The second one is why we have put together a data organization, the reasons for doing that, and the role of this data organization inside of Unidad Editorial. And third, I will share with you a concrete materialization of a data product that we have launched, by the way, something like 1 month ago, more or less. This is basically what I'm trying to cover in this speech. So, the key element here is that the user behavior has changed completely in the last years. As you know perfectly well, a few years ago, newspapers were basically print copies that people bought at the kiosk. But now this has changed completely. Now we are in the digital world. So people is accessing content, especially news, through their mobiles, equipments, through PCs, etc., etc. So this is the real transformation of this. So just to give you an example of this, I'm sure that you remember this. This happened just 1 year ago. It was the 25th October 2015. And as you can see here, in one of our brands, Marca is leader in sports, we have a really, really significant audience. If you compare this number with the audience of the television channel, it's really, really, it's really, really amazing. I mean, this is basically telling us that digital audiences are becoming more and more important. Even the, in the Gran Premio of Valencia that took place 1 week after, of course, television, generated a lot of interest. But even in that case, audience in the digital newspaper was really, really, really high. So basically, what is going on is that digital audiences, and this is obvious for you, I'm sure, but basically I'm putting some numbers here, are really, really important. In Spain, we have a population of 30 million of internet users. For this 30 million, 21 million, according to Comscore, are coming to our newspapers or magazines, etc., every month. So we are basically accessing or touching 70% of the internet population in our sites. So this is a huge digital population. And again, mobile is one of the key elements here as well. So we are not talking only about digital population, we're talking about mobile digital application. So in this context, what we are trying to do is, well, we have to transform our business models. We know that basically we are acting upon digital audiences. What can we do with that? So basically what we are doing is four things. The first one is we are trying to become a user-centric company. So instead of designing this watering cans, just thinking in the, as you say, in yourself, we are trying to think in the user of the watering can, in this case, the gardener. So the idea is just collecting as much information as possible about the user. We are transforming the way we design products. We are transforming our development teams, etc., so that we can incorporate the voice of the user in this design process. This is one of the things that we are doing. The second thing, and I will cover this point later, is advertising. As I said before, advertising is one of our key levers. So in this digital world, we need to make sure that we provide the impression to the appropriate person at the right time in the right device. And for doing so, we need to collect many, many data from these users, from all these digital audiences. I'll cover advertising in a second. The third thing is everything around customer lifecycle. When we talk about customer lifecycle, we are talking about basically understanding that readers can become registered users, and registered users can become eventually subscribers. So basically what we are trying to understand is the business value of our users. This is basically what we are trying to do. And we are doing this connecting all our CRM systems and subscription systems with big data infrastructures. I won't cover this point in this meeting, but this is a key element as well. This is at the end of the day about loyalty, about building this relationship with our readers. This is what we are trying to do. And for doing this, data becomes a key element. And then we go for data. And this is the objective of this speech. So what we decided, and this was 1 year ago, more or less, is to build a new business unit. It's a data unit. I'm going to use a Spanish word, which is a dirección general, okay? So inside of the group, this is something like a business unit. It's a peer with advertising, with sales, with logistics, etc. So we decided to create a business unit called Data. In this business unit, what we did was to integrate all the elements, encompassing everything around data, meaning technology, meaning analytics, and meaning everything around activation of data. So basically what we did was putting together all these three elements in a single business unit, at the same level of all the business units of the corporation. So this model basically is allowing us to go from content to monetization. So basically our objective is to create all the infrastructures and skills so that we can go from understanding the content that we are presenting to our readers to how we can monetize this content, normally using advertising, but also using some subscriptions, okay? So this is basically the idea. So I think that the best definition of this team is a complex adaptive system. I don't know if you've heard this configuration before. Actually, there are some algorithms based on these models. The data unit is basically something like a living organism that is totally integrated with the business units of the organization. Although we are a central team, meaning that all the people in the data unit from a reporting perspective is reporting within the data unit, we have put together an organization which implies a lot of interconnection with all the other parts of the organization. So as I said before, there are three key elements within this data unit. The first one is technology. I mean, it's impossible talking about big data without talking about technology. In our case, the decision that we made was we cannot keep the same pace of our central system or technology department. This was a risky decision. Of course, we wanted to keep alignment with them, alignment with the level of decisions about typology of servers, networks, etc. But we wanted to make sure that we can make our own decisions. This is because innovation at a data unit takes place at a very, very fast pace. In my opinion, this is a key element, especially at the, say, initial stages of development of a data unit. Otherwise, the level of development of, say, centralized systems organization could act as a stopper, at least could slow down the process of innovation of a data unit. This is why we decided to do so. We have also put a lot of focus in the development of methods and frameworks. So we are not only using tools. We have invested a significant amount and time in developing our own frameworks when it comes to data ingestion and data transformation especially, also for data modeling. We have created some frameworks as well in this area. Then we have analytics. In the case of analytics, the team is composed of different skill sets. We have, data science. In this case, we have people with a mathematics or statistics background, and also people from the machine learning side. And we are basically making these two cultures collaborate in the same team. So we have this data science teams. We also have digital analytics teams working together. I will explain this in a second. What is really, really important here is what you can see in the slide, walking the last mile. I think what is really, really important is to have the data unit having a direct responsibility in the production of the models. Not only developing the models, but also having a direct responsibility in that model working in the production environment. So this is a key element in my opinion. In terms of the structure of this data unit, what basically I defined is these four interconnected teams. I mentioned this a moment ago. I mean, basically, what we have is a data engineering team. In this case, we are talking about basically people coming from computer science skills, so experts in Hadoop, experts in SQL databases, NoSQL databases, everything around systems, etc. So what we have here is everything around data ingestion and data transformation mainly. Then we have data science. I already covered this. And then we have digital analytics. In my opinion, especially in a digital company, it's really important to have these teams integrated into the data unit. By digital analytics, I mean experts in, say, Google Analytics, Adobe Analytics, these kind of tools, and all the descriptive analytics around traffic. I think it's really important to have these people integrated. Why? Because in our case, collecting this data is just the beginning of the process. If this is not done, very, very well, you will lose a lot of quality in your models. So we have these people, the digital analytics team, working very, very closely with data engineering and data science as well. And then we have business development. Business development is about thinking in terms of what will be the activation of this model into the business ecosystem. What we are doing is our job is basically addressed to advertising, and I will be describing one specific product that we have created in this area, advertising. We are working with subscriptions and sales. In this case, we are providing all the data infrastructure for acquisition, retention, churn prevention, etc. Then we are providing data infrastructure for logistics, in this case with the help of Pau, by the way. And we also are working with the content, with all the publications. Basically, how a content is being consumed and what are the key analytics elements around content. So we're working in these four different areas. And we have people with some expertise in each of these areas. A key element as well is that these teams, although they are separated teams, they work together in the same space. And not only that, normally a project, a real project, implies the participation of people from these different teams. So for example, if we are building a prediction model for improving CTR in a advertising impression, we will have the collaboration of people from digital analytics providing all the descriptive analytics around this campaign. We will have people from data engineering because probably we will be capturing some data points in these creativities and these locations of the web page. And then we will have people from data science really building the models. Not only that, but also we have defined a model where the people entering into the team start their careers as data engineers. And then, as they understand what is going on from a technical perspective, they move toward data science roles, especially with the people coming from computer science skills, people with machine learning knowledge. We even in this case have these people working as data engineers before they become data scientists. As I said before, generating this business value implies to walk this last mile. Our job implies having the model in production, generating business value. So this is the only way of having a business unit really, really integrated into the business. So we use some techniques of co-creation with the business units of what is the scope, what are the objectives of the project, what is the project scope, and what are the ROI of this project that we are trying to achieve. And this is defined along with the business unit. We act as a, I would say, as a change agent in the organization. Because basically what we are doing as part of our job is generating this culture of embedding data and embedding analytics into the business processes. And this implies to generate a multi-language, multi-culture model. So not all the people in the data unit is able to sit along with some business stakeholder and define the scope of the project. This requires the ability of understanding the language of the business. And at this point of time, few people in the organization is able to do that. And this is something that we need to do, on a daily basis. We also organize many, many workshops and internal, say, training sessions to explain what we are doing to the business units so that they understand what is basically this of the, this thing called big data. And I think that it's really, really important, and this is basically, just stressing the point that I described earlier, is just to have a complete, holistic vision on this. Big data is not only about building models, it's not only about doing data transformation. Big data is about connecting all the dots from what should be done in order to collect the data to what should be done in order to have the model in production. So we try to, of course, in doing this, we have to collaborate with many people in the organization, business units, our legal unit, of course, and also the technology units. And as a concrete example of this, 1 month ago, more or less, we launched a product called UE Data. This is a product totally based in big data concepts. Basically, this is the materialization of a big data product. This is a solution for, it's an audience segment solution addressed to our big customers, to our advertisers. Basically, what we have done is create a product that address the key transformation that we are seeing in advertising. Basically, our advertisers are looking for, just impacting the appropriate target to gain transparency and to improve conversion. So basically, what we have done is define this product. This is based, of course, in what I described earlier, in all this, traffic that we are able to generate, the reputation of our brands, the quality of the content that is able to attract readers. And then we basically put all this infrastructure just to collect this data. We have invested in the team, we have invested in infrastructures, and this combination teams, infrastructures, allows us just to build really, really sophisticated algorithms. And with these algorithms, we have defined these audience segments addressed to the advertisers. This is, we have been working with this, since last year. And this is an example of how the collaboration with the advertising team could develop a new product that they are going to sell now, to position in the marketplace. I won't go into the details of this. This is just an example of how a data strategy can generate a new product that a sales organization can bring to the marketplace to generate new revenues. So basically, what we have done is creating 165 audience segments that our sales teams can position in front of our customers in order to improve the performance of their campaigns running our websites. I won't go into the details of each of these, say, audience segments. What is really important here is that the effort consisted not only in defining the audience segments, but mainly in generating this engine that allows us to create any segment based on the requirements and needs of our customers. So basically what we have done is we have created an infrastructure based in a data lake, based in a DMP platform, so that we can basically build the segment to the customer. So a customer is interested in generating a segment of the people that will convert in their specific funnel. So what we do is we pixel their funnel, and we basically do audience extension with them so that we can collect data from their side and build our models based on the data that we collect from their sites. This is going to be addressed to programmatic, performance, branded content, and also, as I said, audience extension. And that's it. My summary will be, in a media company, the situation that we are experiencing is that we need to transform completely our business models. And data is playing a key role in this. This is the reason why we have created this different business unit with fully interconnected with the different elements of our company. What we see is that media and technology basically are converging, and the kind of companies that we are basically transforming are new media companies. We see ourselves as software companies, as technology companies, as data is becoming more and more important. And that's it. This is my, well, thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Adam. Thank you, Paul. We'll start the Q&A now. So I'll start myself with a couple questions, but then we'll open a round of questions for everyone. From your talk, you both in a department or even as a business unit, I understand that what you're saying is that data/analytics should be as such a department like any other department with direct relationship with the CEO of the company, yeah? So my first question is, do you think this is specific of media or / classified ads, or is it something that you would generalize to any industry that you can think of, whether this particular arrangement is the optimal one compared to other arrangements that could be having analytics completely distributed in the organization, having analytics hanging from business, having analytics hanging from IT, hanging analytics hanging from somebody else? Yeah. So this would be question number one, whether this is generalizable or not. And the second one, you've both elaborated in how you integrate with business, yes? So your internal or external clients and how to engage with them. But you haven't talked too much about how you engage with other internal providers, mainly the IT department. So what kind of relationships do your departments have with the IT department? How you engage in, fruitful, positive relationships, and where does the work of one department end and when it's the other department start? Because you're talking about lots of data transformation, which is stuff that typically was done by IT departments. So how do you coordinate with the IT departments and your company? So these are my two questions. Adam?
Sure. So on generalizing to other kinds of businesses, I think in some way or another, this kind of function that has been happening in most successful companies all along, I think the key difference in, the past decade plus has been the rise of the internet and just the sheer volume of data that generates. And so any business that's operating online all of a sudden has a flood of data, and there's been an entire industry that's developed around, like, how do you manage that? What do you do with that? How do you actually extract value from that? And so I think that, you know, what both of us were talking about is exactly how to do that. And you're going to find this, I think, with more and more companies. So, you know, with, for example, oil extraction. So more and more you're going to have sensors all over the wells, and you're going to, and this is kind of ties into the Internet of Things, and you're going to have this flood of data coming, you know, no matter what industry you're in. So I see it as, it's a trend that's, I think, going to expand to virtually everything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I have pretty much the same opinion. I think that data can be seen, I mean, I think that the differences basically are related with how data is, seen in the organization from the top management perspective. I think that in some industries, it's seen as a risk, so data is a risk. In these cases, I think that the configuration will be having the CDO reporting even to the CEO directly, or maybe to the financial areas. The other perspective is seeing data as a business opportunity. I think that in the case that you see data as a business opportunity, then definitely you will be reporting to the CEO, or maybe at some point some marketing or even sales areas. But according to what I see, especially in Spain, if we take a look at the IBEX 35, we are seeing a growing number of examples with CDOs reporting to the top management, to the CEO. So and I think that is going to be the case for the coming years.
And
so the second question?
So relationships with IT.
Yep. You go first.
Yeah, so the group that I'm a part of in Schibsted doesn't have a traditional IT department per se, but we do have a lot of different parts of both technology and product and every other part of the company virtually that we have to work with. And the issue for me always comes down to, at what level does the system that you're responsible for generalize? So we have a group actually in Schibsted called Infrastructure, and they work on things that are common to any technology development that we're going to be doing anywhere. My team is responsible for things that particularly involve data. And then there's another group that works on things that can, you know, different components that can plug into different areas of the product. And then, of course, there's the actual product teams. And so data is often in the middle of this chain. So we'll have infrastructure, which we rely on and we're a customer of, and then we're also a provider to many different user-facing product areas. And so managing all of these relationships, you know, I find that it's actually it's a full-time job that we have, a technical program manager, to basically facilitate, okay, let's follow a technology pipeline from beginning to end and make sure that everything is happening in sequence. Because without somebody actually focusing on that, it is incredibly difficult to have a coordinated roadmap so that if I rely on this functionality in order to deliver this for my customer, I need to know your team's going to be able to provide this by a certain date, and it can become quite complex, but that's the nature of the working relationship that we have, although we don't have like a IT department per se.
So I think that you touched one of the key points. There are a lot of, I would say, creative tensions between a data unit and a technology or systems unit. And I think that this, at the end of the day, the tension between innovation and quality of service. And this can be incarnated in many, many, say, forms. So just to give you two concrete examples of this. Product development, in our case, many, many times, tends to forget the importance of tagging, of control tags, of collecting the right, all the data that we need to build the models. So it is, a continuous fight just to being part of these development teams, participate in these committees, and making sure that all the tagging is done in a correct way. So this is a concrete example of this. And this is generating some tensions, because many times tagging implies extra effort for the development team. But from a data perspective that is directly connected to the strategy, we need to do that. Otherwise, we will be losing data that will allow us just to monetize. So this is one concrete example. The other example is once you have built a model, and in our case, we have hundreds of millions of cookies every day, that every day, every night, we have batch processes just to build the analytics segments associated to these cookies. So we need to make sure that the hashing, we use some platform for hashing this analytic segments in memory. We need to really, really make sure that this has been done correctly, that, the production environment of the webs, of the apps, whatever it is has been completed correctly, that any incidents has been managed, et cetera, et cetera. So we need to be part of this process. So I think that at least at the, say, initial stages of a data unit, it is good to have this centralized team, but then you will generate the need of this dialogue. Maybe at some point, when all the culture of collecting the data, of embedding the production models into the production systems is totally developed, and all the processes in the systems and technology departments are developed, once you have this, maybe we can hunt technology over to their place.
Questions. So please say your name and make a concise question so that we can get as many as possible.
Hi, I'm David from Issues. My question goes for all three.
For
Alan Pound.
You do Pound.
Yes. My question is short. Maybe the answer is a little bit longer. I would like to know how do you see the possibility of opening data in corporate? I mean, kind of corporate open data. Is it useful for you? Is it in your thoughts at any point? Thanks.
This is a tough one.
So opening data as in opening data to anybody to work with externally? Is that what you meant?
Yes, for example.
Yeah. I see value in certain cases. So as a general rule, no, because I see data as one of Schibsted's most valuable assets. Our data and our understanding of data is absolutely critical to our success. So we wouldn't want to, for example, open that up to our competitors being able to access that data. There are, so another consideration there is user privacy, and even if you're trying to anonymize data and things, it's actually extremely difficult to truly anonymize data, and you can get yourself into some trouble. AOL, a number of years ago, opened a data set and ended up violating privacy without any intent to do so. There are cases where if you can get a cleaned data set, I think that it's a good thing to release it, both for building ties to the academic community, which is very important, having a give and take with different universities, both for having a relationship with them for attracting talent, and also just for research partnerships and exchanges of ideas can be very valuable. And then the second area is if you want to do competitions, and this is again tied to attracting talent and kind of building a brand around data in particular, then having a data set that you release for competitions can also be really valuable.
Yeah, I think that open data, the open data initiative, an idea, it's difficult to apply this concept directly to a private organization, especially when you see data as a lever to generate additional revenue. Then, as was mentioned, legal issues are really, really important. So this is another really, really critical aspect. But maybe there are complementary concepts that we will see developed. And actually, we have started to work in this direction, which is something like making, second party data agreements with different agents. This is not open data, of course, but this is about creating a data infrastructure that is shared among a reduced number of participants so that you can generate value not only for you, but also for the participants in this platform. In fact, the DMP infrastructures that we are being basically, that we are developing, one of the key elements that they are going to allow is this model of, collaboration among private parties so that data can be shared, improved, enriched. But this is not open data, with the definition that we normally use open data in the public space.
More questions?
Good evening, this is Luis Velasco from the Hewlett Packard Enterprise. So I think we're having here a very interesting discussion whether the data organization should be reporting straight to the CEO. To me, that means that this organization should have a full P&L responsibility. Tracking the cost side is very straightforward, but when it comes to the profit side, how do you actually track and tag additional revenues to your organizations? Because at the end, it's kind of an indirect sales that you're making, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's an excellent question. It's one I've been thinking about a lot lately, actually. Going back to, the different kinds of teams that I talked about, some are easier than others, and data products is usually the easiest. Because you're trying to influence some kind of business metric, usually with any kind of product feature. So if you're working on ad targeting, the profit side is pretty straightforward usually. If you're working on something like search or recommendation systems or image recognition or something like that, you have to look at usually it's some kind of user engagement metric or something you're trying to move. And there you have to have an understanding of how that maps to overall revenue, and it has to be a formula that basically everybody in the company can agree on so that you've got a fair playing field. Because oftentimes, user growth goes up and everybody wants to take credit for it, and then user growth goes down and then nobody wants to take the blame. So you have to all agree on how you're going to account for these things. Then for data processing and for data processing kind of should be baked into the end value for anything. So whether that's a data product or whether that's insights. The value for insights is very difficult, I find, to really quantify. You can go and say, okay, these are specific product directions that we went in because of things that we found in the data. And so there are some things you can do, but I really don't ultimately have a great answer for the insights side of things and how you properly fully capture the value that it really brings.
Yes, I think that with some business areas, it is easy to establish this connection. And in fact, I would say that you need to establish this connection even before starting the project. So if you want to increase the CTR, this is something very, very tangible that you need to define. If you want to increase the conversion rate of your campaigns for acquiring subscribers, this is something really, really easy to measure. So in some occasions, it is a very, very, I would say, defined KPI that will allow you to basically to define what is the return of your initiative. I agree with the fact that in many occasions, some strategic insights are difficult to monetize directly. But in these cases, I think that it's much more about making the top management aware of how important are these insights in terms of a strategic positioning, in terms of competition, in terms of many, many other aspects.
More questions? Hello, my name is Andres. I work for Schibsted Spain. I have, okay, two questions. First of all, do you think your companies are data-driven? And second of all, how do you think a company can become data-driven in the culture and in their older their habits, their working every day?
Sorry, I didn't catch the first part of your question.
Do you think your companies are data-driven right now? I mean, in all the things and the infrastructure you already have?
I would say overall, Schibsted has made tremendous progress in being data-driven. I have a very high standard for what I consider to be data-driven, and I don't think that we're there yet. Mostly that has to do with, you know, I think every functional area in the organization uses data to make decisions generally. And the part where I would like to see us get even better is in having an integrated approach where we understand the relationship between the data that's being used in one area of the organization versus another area of the organization. And that's a process where you have to build up that knowledge and expertise over time. It doesn't happen overnight. And I find that the cultural change usually, that's one of the core functions of a data organization, I think, is to lead the cultural change and to be a role model for it and to show people how to do it. One of the things that I thought was really successful that I did in my time at Twitter is participated in these experimentation meetings where we would gather all the product managers together and we would talk about experiments. And the rule was we weren't going to make a decision about what launched or didn't launch in that meeting. We were just going to talk about what we learned from the experiments and especially try to bring in the quote-unquote failed experiments, because those are often the ones that you learn the most from. And organizing that kind of thing had, I think, a profound impact on the way that the product organization at the time thought about data and treated experiments and treated experiments as a learning opportunity rather than just okay, this determines whether or not I get to launch my feature.
I think that, it is difficult to say that we, in our case, Unidad Editorial, are a data-driven company. What I would say is that we have a need. The pressure of digital transformation and the pressure of this transformation towards digital audiences. So I would say that every business leader in the organization is aware of the importance of this. And being aware of the importance of this, they are also aware of the importance of data, because data is basically data points and then data insights are key for understanding this new business. So in my opinion is, we are basically, it's like evolution, biological evolution. I think that this is what is going on. Another thing is having these business leaders, fully competent, understanding what is the process of building a model, and what does it mean, et cetera, et cetera. I would say that they are not in this stage, but they are able to understand that data is a key aspect, and able to understand that For transforming and for achieving our objectives, we need a data infrastructure, we need a data team, we need to have models working, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I would say that this is the case at the moment. This doesn't imply that these are, fully aware of everything in terms of, the details, but at least of the business impact.
More questions?
Hello, Jean-Marc from ArcB. I wanted to ask, what's the relationship, or what should be the relationship between the data units and the C-level or the executive level of the organizations?
Sorry, between the data units and
The C-level.
And top management.
And the C-level. Yeah. So it depends on the maturity of the data organization, what that relationship looks like. So in the beginning phases, I think that it needs to be almost kind of like a consulting kind of thing. Like, the data organization provides information on what's going on in the business in the form of metrics and dashboards and things like that. Over time, I think that, you know, as the understanding that the data organization has of the business gets more sophisticated, as it increases, then it becomes more and more as a partner that you include in most any kind of planning you're going to be doing or decision making you're going to be doing. Just like in product development, you know, the classic thing is you want to have an engineering person paired with a product person paired with a user experience person, because you need all of those perspectives to make decisions. I think in a mature data-driven organization, you're going to need somebody from data there in order to help think through the decision-making process and in order to supply all the information that needs to go into a decision-making process.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that definitely, the data unit should be part of the top management team. So this is my answer to your question. I think that this is the only way to making sure that you will have the right level of implication of the business units in the transformation. This was our decision, and I think that this is needed if you really want to mobilize to activate the organization. So you are a peer with the, say, advertising director. You are a peer with the sales director. Then you can start really, really establishing dialogues and putting together, common plans. So I think that it's a key element that the data unit is, considered a key business unit in the organization.
More questions?
Hi, my name is Mauricio Rodriguez. I'm part of Vision Analytics. I have a question thinking about all the startups that are here. When do you consider is the right time to start investing specifically into data people within a new project?
For a startup in the early days, I think the answer is you start hiring data people when you feel like you're not going to be able to survive without them, and you don't hire them before that, because you will tend to, if you're talking about like a 5 to 10 person company, for example, I think unless DNA, you know, unless data is like the DNA of your company, like what you're doing is a data startup, then you need to focus on getting some kind of product released, because you know, frankly, before that, you don't have any data for a data person to look at. And so, and I also think that there's something to, you can perhaps bring in somebody at the point where you have something released and you want to start getting some analytics in place and things like that. I think that's reasonable. But it's also really important that at the founding of the company, you have people directly engaging with the data themselves across the company, because that's going to pay off dividends in the kind of culture you're building for years down the road. If it's a successful company, it keeps on growing. You want people who are going to be comfortable working with data themselves and getting their hands dirty. And if you build up an analytics team or a data team very early, where you've got like dedicated people to pull data and things like that, then my worry is that you don't have people directly engaging with the data themselves. Now, you do, of course, reach a point where the questions get more difficult, and then you need to bring in real data people and start building a real data team when the volumes of data get sufficient that, you know, you can't just put it in MySQL and then, you know, and it's not a problem. You of course need to start building a data team at that point. But I'm a bit skeptical of building them in the very early days.
Yes, I think that it depends on the level of exposure of your business to the risk of not being a data-driven organization. So in our case, it's clear. We are really, really exposed to this risk. maybe you are in an industry which, data is not that important. It is difficult for me to just to name one, but this could be the case. I was just making a joke. What I'm saying is that maybe in some industries it's not that important. You are not exposed to the risk as you are in other companies, such as in media, for example. So this is one thing. The other thing is the level of maturity of your, basic data concepts. Meaning, are you able to collect the data points that you need? Are you able to store, manipulate this data? If you don't have these very, very basic capabilities, first of all, you have to develop that. Normally, these capabilities are supposed to be developed by the technology or systems teams. If you have this capacity developed, then the idea is how analytics can be incorporated into the organization. And it depends. It depends on what is your level of maturity. If I agree with the fact that if you are not mature enough, you could be moving too fast so that you will not be able to integrate what you are doing with the business units. If this is the case, probably you need to approach this from a consultant perspective. Having someone external to the organization, incorporate this team to your organization and trying to generate value with the help of these people. And then once you have understand this, once you are able to explain this to the business units, start building the business unit by yourself. If you are exposed from a business perspective to the risk.
So I see thirsty faces, so just one more question or it's over? Okay. Time for the beer over there. Thank you very much, everyone.